Hello and welcome to video lesson 29. Today we are going to start off with a fresh unit called Hindi Cinema. I'm sure you have all been waiting for this unit eagerly. But before we can move on with starting off with this unit, let us just do a quick recap as to what we talked about in the last lesson. So in the last lesson we delved a little deeper into the concept of genre in cinema. We talked about genre blending and genre busting, two very important types or contexts in which genre is used. We discussed the various conventions and the tools that are put to use to bring forth both your genre blending and genre busting. And we also delved upon the purpose or the impact of this kind of an edit in the narrative of a film. Now, moving on to today's lesson. So, in today's lesson, as I already mentioned, we are going to talk about Hindi cinema. I'll try to give you a brief overview of Indian cinema as such. So, we will be talking about how is it that filmmaking as a practice in India started and what were the precursors to cinema. So, before cinema, what were the different arts that already existed and what kind of an impact they had on this new concept, this new baby in the block which was cinema. Finally, we will also be touching upon the silent era. Now, I'm sure you're familiar with this concept, silent era, when the films that were made had no music or no dialogues. So, that is what we'll be talking about in this lesson. And by the end of this lesson, what you should be able to do is that you would have been able to trace the beginning of cinema in India, how it all start. You would have studied the role and the impact of the existing forms of entertainment that were available to people and what kind of impact they had on films at that point of time. You will be able to identify the pioneers of Indian cinema. Who were these people, these important people who laid down the foundation for Indian cinema? And you will also be able to gain a very good understanding of the various themes that were explored in the films from the silent era. So, let's not delay and let's quickly get on to what is it about Indian cinema. Before we talk about the origin of Indian cinema and how it all began, let us first talk about Indian cinema per se. I'm sure you can all be very proud about the fact that India actually is the largest producer of films in the world. Yes, in the year 2017 itself, India was able to produce a total of 1,986 films. That's a huge amount of pictures, because if you look at the USA or the other countries that follow later on, the margin is actually quite high. And another thing that is very interesting about Indian cinema is the fact that we have so many different languages, and the kind of cinema that is actually put out is made in as many as 40 different kind of languages. So, you have of course, you have Hindi, apart from that you have Malayalam, Telugu, Bengali, Gujarati and so on and so forth. So, 40 different languages is a huge amount. The history of Indian cinema, it spans more than 100 years. So, you are in for a lot of treasure hunting, I'm sure, you know, as we will talk about Indian cinema as we move forward till today's time. But 100 years of history is actually a huge amount of time, and Indian cinema has evolved a lot. There have been a lot of changes, different kinds of cinema have come along, and it's really interesting to talk about all of them. Another thing very interesting about or very good about Indian cinema is that it is Indian cinema is something that is that enjoys a huge spectatorship. So you have spectators, you have audiences, not just in India, but you know, these audiences, they cross the national boundaries. So you have spectators of Indian cinema not in the neighboring countries, and also in far-flung countries like the USA or the European countries or even the Middle Eastern countries. So Indian cinema, as it is a very popular means of entertainment, not just here in India but all across the world. So yeah, so yes, that was your overview of Indian cinema. Now let us start talking about how is it that cinema in India actually started. So we'll first start talking about the precursors to Indian cinema. So by precursors, what I mean is that what were the different art forms that were already existing when cinema came along? Because these existing art forms had a very strong impact, had a very they had a very defining role in the makeup of cinema as we know it today. What had happened when cinema actually came along was that the environment that existed in India when cinema came to be was actually very conducive to it. So I'm talking about precursors. So these precursors, specifically three important art forms that really impacted cinema, were your paintings, photography and the Parsi theatre. So what these three did was that they were able to provide some kind of a aesthetic and creative and technological infrastructure that would then go on and make the production of cinema, the process of filmmaking, a very wonderful and a very conducive kind of a environment. So let's talk about paintings first. Paintings, what they did was that they laid the foundation or they provided the foundation for the aesthetic aspect of cinema. I'm sure you've heard the name of Raja Ravi Verma, who was this very famous Indian painter, and his visual style came to influence photography and later on a lot of the cinema that was being produced, you know, the cinema that was being worked on during the silent era. So the kind of mythological iconography that was used in cinema was derived from the kind of paintings of Raja Ravi Verma. Moving on to photography. So photography had come into India, had been introduced to India in the year 1840, and by the 1860s, a lot of photography studios had sprung up in Bombay, today as we know it as Mumbai, and Calcutta, a city that we know as Kolkata today. So by the 1860s, a lot of photography studios had sprung up. People had really taken up photography as a profession. And this then was able to lay the foundation, or this was the foundation, the technological foundation, the technological infrastructure that helped cinema to really take on from the very moment it was introduced in India. Finally, a very important, a very key form of entertainment that had a huge impact on the form, on the narrative style of Indian cinema is the Parsi theatre. So the Parsis were actually a very thriving trader community in Bombay. They had travelled from Persia and settled in Bombay and other parts of the country. But so what had happened was that they made Bombay this this cultural and you know, a very business centered kind of a place. So the Parsis, the trader community, it contributed greatly to the economic and cultural development of Bombay as such. These people, the Parsis, they through these tradings, through their business acumen, were able to accumulate a lot of wealth, which in turn what they did was they started sponsoring a lot of theatre, and which is where the term Parsi theatre comes from. So now what happened in Mumbai was that this Parsi theatre specifically, it was actually a melting pot again from a variety of different art forms, existing art forms, not just in India but also from the foreign countries. You had the Shakespearean theatre that had a very strong influence on Parsi theatre. You had the Persian poetry. You also had an influence of your Indian folk traditions and also your ancient Sanskrit dramatic text. So all these things had contributed to what Parsi theatre was, and eventually you will realize as we go on talking about Indian cinema, all these things automatically translated or transferred into Hindi cinema as well. So what all these different influences did was that they were able to produce this very unique blend of a musical narrative. So there was this use of the Urdu language, you know, derived from Persian poetry, and so it was a mixture of Urdu language, it was a mixture of the narrative, musical narrative style, the Indian mythologicals, and also to some amount Western influences. So all these things had contributed to the Parsi theatre. Now, Parsi theatre, it remained a very popular source of entertainment for the people for a long amount of time before cinema came along. So this then provided the creative and aesthetic foundation for Indian cinema and how the filmmaking or how the narrative structure would then progress. A lot of actors and writers who were working in Parsi theatre, for these people working in films kind of became like a natural progression. So initially a lot of actors, a lot of writers had come into films from the Parsi theatre, and most of the cinema, the most of the cinema that was created back then and also that is created today, the typical Bollywood, so to say, that we all know it as, the Bollywood style of cinema that we know to exist today had a great foundation in the Parsi theatre. So a lot of influences from the Parsi theatre. So these were the precursors to cinema. And I talked to you about how is it that these three different kinds of traditional media and, you know, photography, Parsi theatre and paintings, they all contributed and they all helped to create this conducive environment for the origin of cinema. Now let us talk about how was it that India actually came in contact with cinema. So when was it that when the first film was introduced, or when was it that the audience was introduced to the moving images? So we have been talking about the history of other countries. We've talked about Italian cinema, French cinema. We also talked about Latin American cinema, where we talked about Mexico, Brazil. So in all these countries, you had the foreign filmmakers come into India and project their work. Similar thing happened with India as well. So as you know, the Lumiere brothers, who had made the first moving images, after they had done the screening in Paris, they had moved on to various other parts of the country. And associates of the Lumiere brothers also came to India. In the year 1896 and in the July of that month, at least six different films from the Lumiere brothers were shown to the Indian public. Now, when I say Indian public, it actually did not include the domestic people of the country, but this first screening was actually meant for the English people, because India at that point of time was under the British rule. However, very soon enough, this screening was also followed by a screening meant for the Indian audiences, and it was received very, very enthusiastically by the populace. They were really interested in how this entire concept of moving images was working for them. Seeing all of this, this particular art form of filmmaking was rapidly adapted by the Indian art industry as well. So a lot of photographers who had already existed, they turned into filmmakers. They already had the infrastructure for the photography studios, and now they started moving into or converting their studios into something that would be fit enough for making a film. Now, the early moving images, as with other countries, were nothing but your day-to-day glimpses of life as it is. So one of the first films, not one in fact, the first film in Indian cinema is actually an 1899 film, which is known as The Wrestlers, and it was produced by Save Dada. Now, what that film had was, it was nothing but just two wrestlers wrestling, and that was it. So it was a small film. It was like an actuality that we have already talked about when we talked about the beginnings of cinema in the world context. So that was the first film. Apart from that, there was also another person called Hiralal Sen, who was a Calcutta based filmmaker. So he's also one of the pioneers in filmmaking, because he's credited with making the first political film. So by political film, it means it was not just capturing, you know, things as were going on, but a film that would have impact on the political scenario of the country at that point of time, or of the state at that point of time. Now, apart from these local films, there were also the foreign films, the foreign imports that were being shown to the Indian audiences. So these were something like The Life of Christ. There was also Aladdin and the Wonderful Lamp, and Napoleon Bonaparte. These are some of the films that were shown to the people that were foreign exports. Now comes a very important person whose name was Jamshedji Madan. Now he was a Parsi businessman and he saw a great potential in the business of filmmaking, and what he did was he acquired rights to a lot of films and he started setting up studios to be able to show them. So he built a lot of studios. So in 1902 he started with the bioscope shows, which were basically shows that were shown in tents, and he built this into a larger concept. Now by the year 1909 he established the Elphinstone Picture Palace, which was the first film theater in India, and it was established in Kolkata. So gradually this is how cinema was now being introduced to the people of India. So this is how the origins or the beginnings of a cinema in India started. Now, let us talk about the silent era. So, once the filmmaking process had started, once the actualities had been produced, people as in the filmmakers, they now started exploring other categories, other genres as to how this particular cinematograph, the camera, can be used to tell stories. So in 1912, a film came along known as Pundalik. Now this film, there is a lot of debate about whether this film or another of Dada Saheb Phalke's film is actually the first film in Indian cinema, but there is some difference in the kind of film that Pundalik was and the kind of film that Dada Saheb Phalke made. We will talk about that in a little while. So this film was actually the recording of a theatre production. So it was a theatre production that was going on. This theatre production was about a holy man, a priest who was based in Maharashtra, and R.G. Tone was the guy who recorded this particular play. So technically yes, it was a film, but it was not exactly a film because it was a recording of an already existing play. But yeah, 1912, something like a narrative story that people could watch, a moving story that people could watch was introduced to the audiences. Now, so Bombay emerged as this center for Hindi cinema, but there was also simultaneous production centers that were coming up in various other cities of the country. So in a lot of different regional languages, so specifically Kolkata and Chennai. So this is how the beginnings of cinema was actually coming to be. The Indian audiences was introduced to the foreign cinema. The filmmakers started, the photographers who already existed started moving towards filmmaking, and gradually this filmmaking process caught on. Now let us talk about Dada Saheb Phalke. Now this name, again I'm sure you've heard this name already, and it's a very important name, it's a very important person to the history of Indian cinema. Now who was he? Let's just to give you a brief background as to who he was as a person. Now he was an ardent scholar of the creative arts. So he had taken up classes, he had learnt drawing, he had learnt oil painting, he'd also learnt architecture, he had gained practice in photography, in photolithography, in printing, and all the other associated arts. So he was this really well-rounded person who was really into the creative arts. So naturally, when this filmmaking was introduced to him, he was very intrigued by it. In 1910, when he was watching the film Life of Christ, he was pretty intrigued by it. He also very famously said, like after he watched this film, this is what he said. He said that, "I felt my imagination taking shape on the screen. Could this really happen? Could we, the sons of India, ever be able to see Indian images on the screen?" Now, this is a question that really pushed Phalke to take up filmmaking, because he was looking at images that were foreign. He was looking at stories that were not exactly coming from India. And this is what pushed him to, like intrigued him to take up the camera and start telling stories that were actually about India. So in 1912, he travelled to London, and the idea behind him travelling to London was that he wanted to familiarise himself with the filmmaking techniques and also understand what all is the required equipment. So he did all of that, and once he came back, he set up a studio, a filmmaking studio in Bombay. In 1913, he shifted this entire studio to the city of Nasik because he believed that Nasik had the area around Nasik had better imagery that suited the Indian stories, that would do wonderful background work for the Indian stories. And within a year, he had made the first feature length film of India. So in 1913 came along Raja Harishchandra. This film was touted as the first film of Indian manufacture. Now, it's important to actually see where all of this is coming from, because we've already talked about how India was in the throes or in the big or in the middle of this struggle for independence. So automatically, a lot of the domestic people, you know, the Indian citizens were against the British government. So this film, like filmmaking as a tool, and filmmaking as a tool where Indian stories could be told, was something that was at the heart of Phalke. So he was driven by this nationalistic and anti-imperialistic ideology, which is why this term, first film of Indian manufacture, becomes very important. The Swadeshi movement, of course, was already on, where people were concentrating more on making things in their own country rather than consuming products that were created or manufactured by the foreign countries. So this is how, this was the basic ideology behind that started off the filmmaking process in India. This, now the narrative style for this particular film, for Raja Harishchand, was borrowed from the paintings, theater, as well as the traditional arts that existed in India. So Phalke tried to move away from the foreign influences as much as possible. Of course, the basis remains the same, that how you tell a story, the narrative structure kind of remains the same, but it still had a very unique style to it as compared to other kinds of cinema that we have already talked about. Indian cinema was something that from the get-go had a very unique flavor, had a very unique color. So this film, of course, it came on to be a hugely successful film. It was received very well by the audiences. And what it did was that it laid the foundation for the kind of future cinema that would be created, or at least for the coming time, which was in the form of the mythologicals. So mythologicals were actually nothing but films that were based in Indian mythology, in the Indian epic poems. So films derived from that. Till today, we do have cinema where you still have stories that actually derive their basic core from the mythologies that have existed in India. In 1918, what Phalke did was that he established the Hindustan Cinema Films company, and it was a production as well as a distribution company. And what it did was that it produced a huge number of films. And huge number of silent films actually, but by the year 1933, it actually came to an end, but it still did the production of a lot of silent cinema during that time. No wonder that Phalke is known as the father of Indian cinema, because he is said to be the person who laid the groundwork for the narrative structure, for the narrative style of Indian cinema, or the unique Bollywood cinema that we know today. That is what was kind of laid by Phalke himself. So one thing that he said was that Indians must see Indian movies on the Indian silver screen. So film then was used as a social and a cultural tool to bring people together, you know, who were united by the same society, by similar cultures, and to give them a sense of being one. So films there acted as a very important tool. Now, in the year 1966, the Indian government introduced the Dada Saheb Phalke Lifetime Achievement Award. To this day, this award is a highly esteemed award, and it is awarded to people who have made outstanding contributions to the world of Indian cinema through their work. So that is how important Phalke was as a figure to the history of Indian cinema. Now, let us talk about how is it that Indian cinema blossomed. So we talked about Bombay, but how is it that Indian cinema moved to the other countries, and how is it that it spread or it grew? So as we talked about this, Bombay had now firmly established itself as the hub for filmmaking, and specifically Hindi filmmaking. So, but a lot of studios had also come up in other cities, specifically Kolkata and Chennai. And by the end of the silent era, you know, that is when your sound was introduced into films, at least 1,000 films had been produced. Now, that is a huge number going by, you know, the fact that India was actually not a free country, you know, during the time the silent cinema was made. But it has this really thriving, really, you know, strong film industry that had been able to produce more than 1,000 films. It also is a comment on the way cinema was received by the people of the country. So the people had really loved seeing themselves, seeing Indian stories on the silver screen. 90% of course, all this cinema has now been lost. But the 10% that remains is able to give us some glance or some glimpse into what the cinema of that point of time had been like. It's really sad that we don't have the cinema from that point of time, but that's how it is. So let's talk about other directors, other filmmakers who had actually pushed forward the filmmaking process. So you have Dhiren Ganguly, who was a director and producer based in Kolkata. In 1918, he had established a production company called the Indo-British Film Company. Under this company, under this filmmaking studio, a couple of interesting films had come along. One was called Bilet Ferat, which basically means England Returned. So it was about a person who has traveled all the way to England, and then when this person comes back, how is it that this person reacts or interacts with the surroundings in his native country. Another film that came from the studio was Yashoda Nandan in the year 1922, and then Sadhu or Shaitan in the same year, 1922. Let's now move on to Tamil cinema. So in Tamil cinema, the name of Nataraj Mudaliar is very, very important. He is known as the father of Tamil cinema. And in the year 1917, he had established the Indian Film Company, which was a studio in Chennai. And the films that came out of this particular studio were the Kichika Vadham in 1917, Draupadi Vastrahanam Haranam in 1918, and Love Kush in the year 1919. So this is how filmmaking was actually really beginning to spread and really be taken up, not just in Mumbai, not just in Mumbai for today, but in the rest of the country. Nataraj Mudaliar, what he did was that he retired from the process of filmmaking in the year 1923. There were some personal tragedies that happened in his life, and he moved on from the process of filmmaking. While all of this was happening, while film was really starting to, Indian filmmaking was really starting to gain ground, the threat from foreign imports was actually not really huge, because the Indian audiences was really glued on to the local themes, to the domestic themes, to the stories that the Indian people could relate with. So the domestic cinema was thriving. It was becoming more and more popular as compared to the existing, or as compared to the foreign imports, because it was built on the already existing entertainment modes, as we've talked about earlier. So it was a very natural progression. Indian cinema was having a really good run, and people were really, really enjoying how this Indian cinema was coming to be. We will now discuss the dominant themes that were explored in the films of the silent era. Now, one of the most important ones is actually the mythological. So it was also something that Raja Harishchand was all about, and a lot of other films had come along, you know, after that, that explored the stories of Hindu gods and goddesses. So these were the films that were based on epic Hindu poems and the myths that had already existed. So texts like Mahabharata and Ramayana, they provided the inspiration for the stories that were now being shown on the screen to the Indian audiences. What these films did was that they had this fight between absolute good and absolute evil, because this is what the epic poems and the myths were all about. So you have Ram in one end, you have Ravan in the other end, two complete opposites. So, and this is what was the basic narrative structure or basic storytelling was in the cinema as well. So this automatically made the domestic cinema very, very popular. Some of the films that come under this category are Raja Harishchandra, that came out in the year 1913, the first feature-length film of India. Then you have Lanka Dahan, which came out in the year 1917, Shri Krishna Janam in the year 1918, and Kali Mardan in the year 1919. There were also some other themes that were explored in the silent era, which were so sometimes there were the historical and contemporary themes, and that came across in films like Pati Bhakti, which came out in the year 1922, Bilat Phera, that we talked about, the film that was produced in Kolkata, which was a romantic comedy, a contemporary story, with a romantic underlying story to it. And also another film called Prem Sanyas in the year 1925, which was actually an Indo-European co-production. Then there were the films that were inspired by literature. So not just mythology as such, but yeah, literature also. So Shakuntala, that was directed by Suchet Singh in the year 1920, is a prime example of this kind of film. Then also Devdas, that came out in the year 1928, which was directed by Naresh Mitra. So these were the themes that were that dominated the silent era, and they continued to dominate the Indian screens for a long amount of time. However, a major shift happened when sound arrived in cinema. So till now, these films were all about actions. There were title plates in between. There were these exaggerated actions as the actors acted as if on a stage, on a theater stage. There was no sound. But once there was a sound that could be integrated into the moving images, a major shift happened, and gradually the talkies took over, and the film content then was dictated by them, and the silent era came to an end. Music in silent cinema. Now, I know that I talked about how there was no music, no sound in silent cinema, but just listen to what I have to say. So although there was no music that was integrated with the film that was being projected on the screen, there was of course live production. There was of course live music that was played by musicians who would sit in the studio, in the theater, when a film was being projected. Because how else would you then maintain the interest of the audience? So along with the title plates, whenever there was some action happening, there were these musicians who would play along some kind of a soundtrack that would do justice to what was being projected on the screen. In the case of foreign cinema, in the case of cinema from Europe or from America, these musicians were violinists or the pianists. So they would play the violin or they would play the piano and provide accompaniment to the visuals. In the case of domestic cinema, this was the instruments that were used were the harmonium and the tabla. So you would have musicians who would play these two instruments and provide some kind of a soundtrack to go along with it. Now, the musicians who would be playing these instruments sometimes would also provide a little bit of dialogue, not a huge full-fledged dialogue, but very, very tiny words like, oh, look here, look there, those kind of things. So this is how the silent era, the films that were produced in the silent era, were like. This was the basic essence of what the films in the silent era were like. So I hope you've enjoyed this. Now let's do a very quick recap of what we have talked about in this particular lesson. So we have traced the beginning of cinema in India. So how did it all begin? The origins of cinema in India. How were the people of India introduced to this concept of filmmaking, to the concept of cinema? We also talked about the role and the impact of the existing entertainment forms that already existed in the filmmaking process. We also talked about the pioneers of Indian cinema, the people who really laid the groundwork for cinema as we know it today. We also talked about the themes that were explored in silent cinema, and also how is it that music was included into this concept of silent cinema. In the next lesson, we will be talking about the arrival of sound in films. So from silent era, we move to the point where sound now become a part of the films, and how it meant the end for the silent era and the beginning of the talkies. We'll also talk about some major filmmakers and the films of the time, and the kind of legacy that the introduction of music, that the introduction of sound has left and still continues to for the contemporary cinema. So this has been your introduction to the concept or to the origin of filmmaking in India. I hope you've enjoyed today's lesson. I look forward to meeting you again in the next lesson. Thank you.